story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
This is Sean Campbell saying, if this one doesn't scare you, you're already dead.
Greetings, Slashaholics, and welcome to another episode of Out of Print Slashers. I am Sean Campbell. I am joined by the 80s Slasher Librarian, Joshua Wuru. How are you doing tonight?
Doing good. How's it going? And we have our true Resident Evil DK here. This is our resident Final Destination nerd. Expert. I'm sorry. So this one we've been kind of putting off a little bit. This book is not my favorite, and I know it's not your favorite, DK. You want to give us some history on this book with you?
I ended up getting the entire series other than Death of the Senses at the same time, and I was reading them in order from when they were released, and I got to this book, and it took me 2 months to finish it the first time I read it. Just because of how slow it was.
it's so... I don't want to say it's the worst book, because it's not. It's nowhere close to the worst book I've ever narrated. But it is just so weird. It's not Death Moon weird, but it is like Hell Lake weird, for those of you that have listened to a lot of the books on the channel. But yeah, DK warned me about this one before I started narrating it. I think that's why I did it first. I did it as soon as I got done with Death of the Senses, because I just wanted to have it over with and gone. But yeah, take us away, Sean.
Yeah, so this whole book takes place in Las Vegas, which I thought was a pretty cool setting for doing this, because I think the last one might have been in New York or something. That was the Death of the Senses. This was a lot more vibrant, and there's a lot of symbolism with the different card games and what's going on, and... One of the women, what's her name? Shauna. Shauna is the one that works with the big like tigers and lions and stuff. So she works in the show. That's Merlin's Tower, because I know they have the Imperial Hotel as well. So a lot of that takes place at Merlin's Tower, and that's where you meet the main characters, which are, let's see, you got Tom and Allie. They're, you know, they got drunk and they got married in Vegas, so they're doing the whole Katy Perry Vegas kind of lifestyle. And then you got Arlen, who's a gambling addict. I liked him a lot. He was pretty good. He's just this guy down on his luck, and you can relate to him chasing the money of Vegas and constantly losing. You got Shauna, who works with the lions and the tigers, so that was pretty cool seeing her. But Detective Ackerman, what a dick, man. He reminded me of that.
All dicks in these
he books. Reminded me of that dick cop from Death of the Senses, who was like, hey, he's a bum. You can't hang out with a bum. And here, it's like the same thing. Arlen's just a gambling bum. And I'm like, this again? Like, he started out like he was going to be redeemed, but then he got to a point where he suddenly forgot and then started acting like a dick again, even though he had seen evidence of all this stuff happening. So. Yeah. Yeah, not really too much new on that end, but...
See, the way I see this book is, like, if Krista Faust had written it, I would be cool with, like, half the book being character development before we got to, like, the death and stuff. But this author, I can't even remember their name. I got the cover right up there on my screen. They're not Krista Faust by any stretch of the imagination. It's not horrible writing. I'm not putting the author down. But, like, this is the problem with Black Flame. These books did not have to be 400 pages long.
Yeah. You know,
it was unnecessary. So, like, the first 200 pages, actually, I think it's like 250, you're spent with these characters, getting to know all these characters that are going to die horribly. You know, you get so invested in them. But you're not in this book, I didn't really get invested in them like I did with, like, Dreamspawn by Krista Faust, you know. I don't know. It seemed like an awful long time to get to the elevator thing. But go ahead.
Well, I mean, first of all, we're gonna have spoilers in this video starting about right now. It's gonna be kind of hard to talk about the book without them. But Man, you want to talk about the death? Okay, the Final Destination prophecy doesn't really start until halfway through the book, but the beginning of this book has this guy named Aldous. He's a maintenance worker guy that gets killed. And it acts like it's going to be Final Destination because, oh, there's something happening with the elevator, and then he dies. But that was just, that didn't link to anything. It's not like his death, he was the brother of Shauna or something. He was just some guy who got killed by some bus, and it was really incredibly random. But I was like, do we need a kill early on to let us be okay with half of the book
not being
to the prophecy again?
For some reason, I thought that was like a Pulp Fiction thing, that like it happened at the beginning of the book, but it didn't actually happen until after the accident, and he was one of the people that got off.
No, because he got hit by
right.
a bus.
You're right. He's just a random guy that maybe they were trying to say that he was part of another set of people.
Well, would it made sense if his death caused like a cable or something to get frayed a little bit on the elevator? And then that would eventually lead to the Final Destination thing. That would have been really cool. I mean, hell, I would have loved if this was what's that one Final Destination book? If Looks Could Kill, if Death was manipulating people, like this guy was part of another game going on where Death was trying to get a couple people, and then that linked into the elevator thing, and then she is in the game.
Like
a jigsaw thing.
Like the book starts out with the ass end of another story that we never got to hear, you know?
Yeah. If the book's going to be 400 pages, it would have been nice to have that story too.
You could have. What do you guys think? Play a clip of this scene of this guy at the elevator and then his death that has nothing to do with the rest of the story?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Throw it in.
All right.
That's good.
Aldous Escobar had a feeling something was seriously wrong the moment he went to get on the elevator. The doors closed on him as he was stepping inside. The rubberized safety bar, the metal strip running down the length of the door between the car and the floor entrance that warned the elevator if something was stuck in the middle, caught him right down the center from collar to crotch. Aldous gave out a strangled cry of pain as the bar slammed into his balls, then retracted. The door opened wide and Aldous stumbled inside, clutching his aching crotch. "Motherfucker," he gasped. Just for spite, he kicked the base of the glass back wall of the car. The metal thrummed hollowly from the impact of the size 9. "Fuck you," he hissed through gritted teeth, unaware of the spittle falling on the lapels of his jacket. He lashed out with his foot again. This time he got the window to vibrate. The only response the machine gave toward its abuser, however, was to softly chime its bell. The red down arrows in the door frame lit up and the doors closed. Aldous angrily punched the button for the basement, then went back to cupping his hands around his boys and occasionally moaning. He was gonna need an ice bag for his throbbing injury whenever he got home. Goddamn doors nearly cut him in half, he thought. Piece of shit. Wasn't maintenance supposed to make sure stuff like that didn't happen? As the elevator descended, Aldous looked out through the glass walls at the incredible night scene that he knew he'd be able to enjoy a whole lot better were he not in such agonizing pain. Merlin's Tower was the tallest building in Las Vegas. Hell, pretty much the tallest building in the entire western United States, from what he'd heard. Edging out the 108-story stratosphere across the strip at 1,208 feet and 114 stories. And the three elevators that ran up and down along tracks on the outside of the hotel casino provided the best view day or night of the neon oasis that stretched out all around it. Of course, it didn't beat the view from the Lady of the Lake, the seafood restaurant on the tower's roof where Aldous worked as a waiter. From there, you could see all of the city, 360 degrees, not just the limited angle you got in the elevators. Still looking down on the lights of the strip from the glass-walled cars wasn't so bad either, in Aldous's opinion anyway. In particular, there were plenty of Sin City to see from this elevator on the tower's south side. From here, he could look out at the tents of Circus, the replica of the Eiffel Tower at the Paris, and far in the distance, the giant pyramid and Sphinx that comprised the Luxor. And even though it was just after 4 a.m, the restaurant, as well as a good deal of the gambling metropolis, having closed for the night, There was still light traffic down on Las Vegas Boulevard, and people on the sidewalks. A 24-hour town this place was, and Aldous was happy living here. The girls he met were always hot, and most of them from out of town, so you could screw them and then not have to worry about any drama afterward. The rents were okay, if you didn't mind sharing an apartment with two asshole roommates. And the job paid pretty well, if you didn't mind working for assholes. All in all, not bad living for a 19-year-old who dropped out of high school in junior year. Sure, there were times the work and the city got to him. Not as bad as it did to his old man, but that was his problem, and he wasn't going to live here forever. He had dreams of a recording career, of making it big, and they didn't involve either croaking out shitty 70s love ballads on some reality show, like those pussy contestants on American Idol, or opening on the strip for some over-the-hill has-been with groupies old enough to be Aldous's grandmother. No, he'd hooked up with a couple of righteous musicians looking to break out like him. Marco Silfen, a club DJ who could tear it up on a pair of turntables, and a mixer, and Ellie Stanfield, a pianist at the Turbo Lounge over on Colorado Avenue. With her on keyboards, Marco on the tables, and Aldous on lead vocals, Trojan, a name he thought reflected their plan to sneak into the music business, would show the Vegas stiffs how music was done correctly. The dream popping into his thoughts like that did wonders for easing the ache in his nutsack. It even brought a smile to his lips. Yeah, Aldous thought, he wasn't long for this town. With any luck, Trojan would be rolling into LA's club scene before the year was out. A few more practice sessions and they'd be ready to take the act out on the road. Aldous reached into his jacket pocket and pulled out his iPod, filled with an eclectic mix of music from Jay Kwan to Beethoven. He had a serious liking for Ludwig von's Ninth Symphony. He unwound the tiny white earphones and put them on, then started running through his latest selection of downloaded tunes. Luckily for Aldous, the elevator wasn't stopping on any floor, so he didn't have to worry about annoying hotel guests with the throbbing noise spilling out of the earphones. Then again, he really wasn't supposed to be riding in any of the main cars, even after hours. As an employee of the hotel, it was required he use the service elevator on the north side of the tower to go to and from the restaurant and the staff locker rooms in the basement. But the service car ran inside the hotel, and the only view it provided was of four metal walls that reminded him of the inside of a dumpster. Not that, you know, he knew what the inside of a dumpster looked like from personal experience. Okay, maybe he did, but it only happened once and there'd been a good reason for it. And so what if he used the guest elevators when he got off work? Did he give a shit about upsetting some drunken tourist trying to sneak out a hooker at 4 in the morning? Oh, hell no. He had more important things to think about. Aldous Escobar's star was on the rise, baby, and soon enough every motherfucker on the planet would know it. Getting bawled out by Joey Congers, the tower's night manager, for not taking the right elevator when nobody else was making use of it, didn't do dick to scare him. Speaking of dicks, Aldous suddenly realized his didn't seem to hurt as much anymore. Maybe the music was helping because he wasn't feeling as much pain as before. He started cautiously moving to the beat, shuffling around the car with his eyes closed. For him, the beat was all there, and it was all right now, and the eye-popping view of the Las Vegas night was immediately forgotten. Until the elevator did a little shimmy of its own around the 42nd floor and momentarily slipped from its tracks. The jump threw Aldous against the window behind him. Then his attention was focused totally on the street, so very far below. Especially when the glass popped out of its frame and took a tumble. He screamed as his momentum nearly threw him out of the car. The desert wind tugged at his jacket, like it was trying to force him into a race with the large glass pane to see who hit the pavement first. Oddly enough, painfully enough, it was his balls that saved him. They slammed into the waist-high safety railing just as Aldous was about to start his dive, and brought a swift end to his forward motion. Another scream flowed from his wide-open mouth. This one was high-pitched and girlish, like he'd just turned castrato, and he tumbled back into the car. The fetal position his legs drew into was an automatic response to the searing pain now orbiting his pelvis. Aldous wasn't even aware he'd done it. Then the elevator was back on its track, continuing its descent like nothing had happened. No alarms had gone off, security hadn't called on the intercom to find out if anyone was in the car, and Aldous hadn't heard the glass panel hitting the street. Maybe the wind had caught it and carried it a few blocks away. It was possible. It was certainly high enough up for something like that to occur, but you'd think a piece of glass that big smashing down anywhere would get somebody's attention. Or maybe he just hadn't heard its crash. That was possible, because as he tried to gain control of his ragged breathing and the racking sobs that shook his body, he realized his earphones were still plugged in. The music piping into his ears was moody and melodramatic. Normally, Aldous would have tossed it off as typical goth music, shit about death and destruction and the like. But right there, in that moment, it made a weird kind of sense. As he lay on the carpeted floor of the car, using his jacket sleeves to wipe away the tears running down his face, he slowly realized what was going on. As irrational as it sounded, the fucking elevator had just tried to kill him. Okay, so maybe not the elevator itself. That was just too crazy a notion, even for a guy who couldn't think straight because his nuts felt like they'd swelled up to the size of grapefruits. But something had caused the doors to close, to try and crush him, and something had tried to toss him out of the car, and he didn't think any of it had to do with faulty wiring or the track being out of alignment. It had never slipped its groove before, as far as he knew. Maybe that Grim Reaper stalking shit had some truth to it. Not everyone saw it that way, as he found out a few minutes later. The elevator made it to the basement without further incident, and Aldous managed to pick himself up off the floor and stagger out of it. Every step had been sheer agony, and he half expected the doors to make one more attempt at playing Nutcracker. Surprisingly, they hadn't. But then he had the misfortune to run into his shift manager, Tony Augustino, who could be a real ball buster in his own right.
"What? So you're the prick who dropped that pane of glass in the swimming pool?"
was his initial response after Aldous told him about his near-death experience in the elevator from hell.
"Didn't Mr. Congas fucking tell you not to go riding in that fucking guest elevator? You're supposed to use the fucking service one. How many times you gotta be told that?"
Augustino was pure old-style Vegas, a rumpled old paisan in his 60s who held back to the days when the mob ran the town. Maybe he used to be somebody back in New York, but that was 80 pounds and a natural brown hair color ago. Now he was just a pathetic reflection of the good fella he used to be a lifetime ago, and still thought he was. Not that Aldous really gave a shit about that, what with his aching nutsack and his brush with oblivion. He was thrown by the response he got from the old fart, and a little angry.
"Wait a minute! You're giving me shit about what elevator I gotta take? When I'm telling you the fucking thing almost killed me?" "It ain't your job to tell me shit," Tony snapped. "You're a fucking busboy."
"Waiter," Aldous corrected him.
"You're supposed to do what you're told,"
Tony concluded, ignoring him.
"Yeah?"
Aldous pointed at the elevator.
"And what if one of the guests had been in it just now, and they'd taken a dive out of the window instead of, oh, me almost taking it? Would you be telling Mr. Congers it was their own goddamn fault? You ought to be thanking me for finding out something's wrong with it, not biting my fucking head off." "Listen here, smartass. You shut your fucking mouth. You shut that fucking mouth of yours, or I'll shut it for you," Tony warned. "I've taken all the shit from you I'm going to take for one night. We're done."
He turned to walk away, stopped, apparently figuring he wasn't done just yet, and wheeled back around. He thrust a sausage-like finger into Aldous's face.
"And don't think for one fucking minute I'm going to let you put my ass in a sling with Mr. Congas, because you were joyriding around in a guest car and went busting out a window. Because you know he'll try and make me the fall guy, what with me being your supervisor and all."
He jabbed the finger into his subordinate's chest hard, like he was trying to poke a hole in it.
"But I ain't going down all alone, Aldis, and you can take that to the motherfucking bank."
"But what about the elevator?" Aldous asked. "What are you going to do about that?" The index finger levitated up from his chest, back to hovering within inches of his face.
"You let maintenance worry about that, bus boy," Tony replied. "Just get on your fucking knees when you get home tonight. And thank God that window you popped didn't kill somebody. Otherwise, you'd be talking to the cops right about nows."
He leaned in close, apparently to emphasize his point. But the only things Aldous focused on were Augustino's yellowed teeth. The asshole needed a good flossing.
"Want some advice? You should be worried more about keeping your fucking job than fucking around where you're not supposed to be, and then expecting other people to clean up your shit."
"Is that a fact?" Aldous said hotly.
"Yeah, that's a fact. And if you don't like it,"
Tony gestured toward a nearby emergency exit door,
"you can walk the fuck out of here right now and don't be coming back."
"I got a better idea," Aldous replied with a sneer. "Maybe I'll walk the fuck out of here right now and go straight to Mr. Conger's. Let him know all about what happened. How you think he's going to react when I tell him I tried giving a warning about one of the elevators breaking down and my supervisor told me to fuck off and mind my own business? You think he's going to lie?" Tony's hand closed around his throat before he could finish the sentence. Aldous grunted as he was slammed against the wall. The back of his head bounced off the smooth concrete, the impact sounding like someone striking a ripe melon. Bright little stars and swirling black dots swarmed across his vision.
"You want to fuck with me, Escobar?" Tony growled. "I thought you was a smart boy."
"Smarter than you, you fuck," Aldous said. Tony gave his windpipe a little two-handed shake.
"No, you isn't. You just like any other dumb fucking wetback stinking up this city, Escobar. And the desert's full of dumb fucking wetbacks who thought they were smarter than guys like me. You get me?"
"I ain't a Mexican," Aldous replied through gritted teeth. He pulled at Augustino's hands.
"And how smart it make you when you're doing time in prison for killing a waiter?"
They locked eyes for a moment, then Augustino apparently saw the logic in the young waiter's argument and backed off. He released Aldous and dropped his hands to his sides. Aldous gasped for air and rubbed his sore throat. Now he had something to take his mind off the ache in his nether regions.
"You caught a break, Escobar," Tony commented. "That's 'cause I'm such a fucking reasonable guy."
Again with the warning finger.
"But you crack wise with me again, or you go running your mouth to Mr. Congas and make any trouble and you'll be standing in an unemployment line in a fucking wheelchair. You hear me, bus boy?"
Standing in a wheelchair. It didn't make a goddamn bit of sense, but Aldous got the gist of the message and knew that trying to correct Tony's mangled warning would be a real dumbass move. All he wanted to do now was get the fuck out of the hotel. Two close encounters with death were more than enough for one night. Best to make tracks before the old saying about the third time being the charm turned out to be for real.
"Yeah, I hear you, Tony," he said. "I got it."
Augustino placed a gentle hand on his shoulder like they were pals again.
"Good boy. Smart boy. Now you run on home and stop your worrying. I'll give maintenance a call, let them know what's what with the elevator. They'll have this whole thing fixed up before Mr. Congas even knows it happened."
His hand moved around Aldous's shoulder to roughly draw him into a tight, not-so-friendly embrace.
"But you're gonna stay off the fucking guest cars from now on," he growled. "We clear on that, Aldous?"
Aldous nodded. Anything to rack this up and get the fuck away from this psycho godfather reject. "Yeah, Tony, you don't have to tell me twice." Augustino smiled.
"All right, then. So I guess we're all good, as you kids say, right?"
He slapped the waiter on the back. Aldous felt his teeth rattle from the impact.
"Now go on. I'll see you tomorrow."
Aldous hurried to his locker without a backward glance, grabbed his knapsack, and booked out of the hotel basement as quickly as possible, through an exit door that led to the underground parking garage. His hand shook a little as he pulled his car keys from a zippered pouch on the front of the bag. Fuck it, he thought. Fuck him, fuck this hotel, fuck everything.
He rubbed his throat again. Goddamn asshole might have fucked up my voice. Could have cost me my whole fucking singing career. Maybe I'll have a doctor look at it. As he climbed inside his red Mini Cooper, the nervousness began to fade, replaced by an all-consuming anger. Aldous slammed the driver's side door, then sat gripping the wheel in a stranglehold for a few seconds. His lips pulled back in a snarl. I don't need to put up with this shit, he decided. Why should I? So I rode in one of the guest cars. Big fucking deal. The damn thing almost killed me, right? That fat old bastard ought to be grateful I gave him the heads up. But does he act grateful? Oh, hell no. He tries to snap my fucking neck and tells me to keep my mouth shut. He keyed the ignition, stomped on the gas pedal, and tore out of the garage onto Paradise Road, heading south. The first pink glimmers of sunrise were coloring the east, but Aldous was in no mood to admire the view as he stopped at the red light on the corner of Sahara Avenue. Maybe I'll talk to Marco and Ellie later, he thought. See if there's any openings where they work. I don't need to take that psycho shit from Augustino anymore. And if that elevator acts up again and tries to kill some other poor bastard, well, I tried to warn them, right? Not my fault if Tony fucking Augustino wants to keep it a secret. Let him take it to his fucking grave for all I care. Aldous was so caught up in his internal monologue, so focused on making plans for when he showed up for his shift that night, when he'd tell Augustino to go fuck himself and then walk out of the tower forever, that he never saw the van racing across Sahara Avenue as its driver tried to beat the changing traffic signal. Didn't notice the driver lose control of the vehicle and send it hurtling across the lanes right at him until it was too late to get out of the way. The van hopped the curb, spun in the air once, twice, long enough for Aldous to see the terrified expressions of the teenage driver behind and the girl who sat beside him, and then it slammed down on the roof of the Mini Cooper. The impact crushed Aldous against the steering wheel, and he screamed as his ribcage shattered, the fragments of bone puncturing his lungs, his heart. Some pieces erupted outward, through his chest to stab like skeletal fingers at the stereo buttons on the steering column. The only sounds Aldous could hear were the explosive coughs that ripped from his throat, each one spurting blood across the dashboard. Dark, thick clots bumped their way across the leather-upholstered dash as they were carried along by the flow. Then they, along with the seemingly never-ending river of blood that poured from Aldous's mouth, cascaded down to join the pool of bodily fluids already forming on the floor mat under his feet. As he lay dying, Aldous felt the desert breeze swirl through the shattered windshield. It stroked his blood-spattered cheeks, his lips, cooled his forehead with its gentle caress. The first thing, the oddest thing that came to his mind, was that he finally knew what people meant when they said they'd felt the touch of death. So it was true. He realized in those last few seconds of life, the third time really was the charm.
Okay, so where are we? It's just every time you think the Final Destination kills are going to start, you get more backstory on the cute couple that just got married, the gambling bum, Shauna the Entertainer. Just it cycles through all of the characters. There's even this subplot with this child killer, and they're on the run, and I'm like...
I like that part.
Is he part of the prophecy?
Like, I was actually intrigued. I think I even mentioned that in some of my in-chapter talks. I would like to read about the hunt for the child killer. Like, the whole detective going after that guy was kind of interesting. And it does end up kind of tying into it later with that cop's death. But it wasn't enough to, like, make me look forward to each narration. This was one of those books that it felt like work. There's been three books that I've done on the channel that felt like work. And that's Hell Lake, Death Moon, and this one.
Well, it's like at the end of every chapter, I felt it was an episode of the 60s Batman. Will Arlene get out of his family debt? Will Detective Ackerman catch the child killer? Tune in next week. Next week.
Nothing. I had to make it. I had to do something. It was driving me crazy. I had to try to make it fun. What are your thoughts on the first half of this book, DK? Handing it over to you.
Honestly, it all just blurs together because of how mundane everything is. And I did notice when I was reading through it, I had some notes. First of all, I swear this author went to a baby name book and just started picking all of the A's because you've got Aldous, Allie, Agostino, Arlen, Ackerman. And I'm like, can we slow down with the A's?
You said Agostino, right?
Yep.
Okay.
That was Aldous' supervisor. And then, I did want to bring this up, too. On the back of the book, the main character is named Annie, not Allie.
Yeah.
Which, for me, when I first noticed that, I was thinking that maybe the author really didn't care about this book because they allowed something so obvious to go unnoticed. And with the first half of the book, I felt like they were just throwing ideas at a wall, seeing what stuck, and saying, okay, this will cover 400 pages.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe that's why they waited so long to do the debt, like the tragedy thing, the accident. But good God, in the lead up to it, whenever we actually get there, like I kept telling people, I think the next upload is when this is going to happen. Because I don't like reading ahead. I like to, if I can, read the book for the first time as I narrate. I'm like, I feel like it's going to, the next upload is, it's going to happen. You know, I think I said that like 3 or 4 times. Because we got every lead up to it from every character. You know, what they were doing up to that point. And then it would jump to another character. And we'd get like a 2 chapters of them leading up to the elevator. I did like, Shauna working with the lion, with the tigers and stuff. I really thought that was going to go somewhere. It does have an ironic thing later, but it wasn't what I was expecting. We're going to get one of the clips I want to play tonight when we get there is the slot machine, because I think that was one of the coolest kills. So these characters, I don't want to tell people not to listen to this book because I want you to listen to it. If you can get through the first half, it's not that bad. It's actually kind of fun. Some of the deaths are fun. Some of them are and our biggest complaint will come at the end of the podcast. But for time's sake, so we don't turn into this book, 250 pages, you get to know the characters, you know, and stuff like that. And we're going to pick up at the whole accident thing that starts the whole death order thing here. So Sean, I'm going to hand it to you and we'll play a clip of it after you set it up. What is the big death thing in this book? What is it?
Elevator.
Well, that was simple.
Hey, fun fact. Did you know the original Saw movie was supposed to take place on an elevator?
No, I did not know that. I like that movie Devil though, that takes place on an elevator.
I haven't seen that. That's M. Night Shyamalan, right?
Yeah.
I have a love-hate relationship with M.
I'm
going to
tell you who the devil is. I can tell you who the devil is in it real quick if you never
know. I
watch.
Already know who the devil is. It's been spoiled like many times. I've seen it, though.
It's the old evil-looking lady that you can tell is purposely trying to look sweet. It's not even, it's so obvious that it's going to be the old lady that looks evil as it is, but go ahead.
Oh, this is a random interjection. I've been looking at your screen this whole time, and you have the dead man's hand thing. That's supposed to be Merlin's Tower, right?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Anytime that I've ever wanted to go to Vegas, I just go find some random person, give them $1,000, and have them kick my ass.
Okay.
The stratosphere in the background.
Well, I was thinking, you've been talking about Power Rangers so much lately. I'm like, is that a sword? Is that one of the Zords? Like, they pick up to fight.
Kind
of
looks like
Zord
it.
On
like
and some shit. I'm looking at it this whole time. And it looks like the hilt is the top red part. Okay, so, yeah, elevator.
How do they all get to the... How do all of our characters end up in the same building? DK, you're the expert. How do all of our characters end up in the main building, in the elevator? In 60 seconds or less.
I can't do it in 60 All seconds
right. or less. 120 seconds or less.
I forget how they all end up there. Because like I said, when just by the time you get to that point, you're just like so mind-numb.
Just make it up. How did they get there?
Well, aren't Allie and Tom on the way up to a honeymoon suite or something?
Yes.
And Shauna is supposed to be taking... Why the hell did she end up there?
Wasn't she going to break up with her boyfriend or something?
Ackerman? I thought they were going strong.
Oh, maybe I'm thinking of something else. Okay. I said make it up if you can't remember.
I zoned out a little bit, like, when they started... I don't remember how the fuck they got there, but they were there, the and then he was like, shut up, gambling bum.
People's going to be like, what? I don't think these three guys have ever actually read this book. I know that Josh narrated it, but I still don't think he's ever read this book. And I've got proof I read it. But yeah, they all end up at the in this elevator, and we're going to just play a clip of it, and we'll talk about it afterwards. I did think the premonition was pretty cool, and the way that she tries to stop it from happening was pretty intense. So it's going to be a long clip. We're going to play the premonition and the actual event. Going to be a long clip. Here it is.
Roll it.
Allie looked at Tom and grimaced. It sure felt hot in this elevator all of a sudden. The car came to a sudden halt and made a lurch away from the tower. The shift threw everyone backward, away from the doors. Allie shrieked in pain as the weight of 24 passengers slammed down on her, flattening her against one of the windows. The car filled with screams, drowning hers out, and people began making frantic efforts to reach the doors. All the moving around only succeeded in redistributing the weight, so that more of it pressed down on her. The air was forced from her lungs. Her pelvis was being crushed against the metal safety railing. She could actually hear the bones grinding beneath her skin. The same was happening to her face. Her left cheek was pinned against the glass, and she could feel the bones starting to break under the immense pressure. "Please," she whined, but the sound barely made it past her numbed lips. No one could hear her anyway. The sudden shriek of buckling metal was too loud. The elevator lurched again, and it was clear to Allie that the car was no longer completely attached to the side of the building. Suddenly, she was looking straight down at Las Vegas Boulevard, straight down at the cars and the lights and the people who must be passing by below, completely unaware of what was happening 100 stories above them. There were more cries of horror, more desperate attempts to get out of a death trap from which there was no escape. Some male voice yelling for everyone to remain calm, to stop moving about because it was only going to put more stress on the elevator. Another voice telling him to go fuck himself, they were all gonna die. The weight on top of her became unbearable. Allie screamed with what little breath she could summon, knowing that at any moment her skull was about to fracture. Tears filled her reddening eyes, and she dimly thought she could hear Tom calling her name, could feel him reaching out for her, when suddenly, with a loud cracking sound, the window split along both sides, came loose from its frame, and fell out. The desert winds grabbed hold of the glass and swept it high into the night sky, before sending it plummeting toward the strip. For a moment, the relief from the crushing weight was a godsend, but Allie suddenly realized she was looking at a sheer drop of just over 1,000 feet. And the people lying on top of her were pushing her through the gap where the glass had been. "Oh God, no!" she screamed and threw her arms out to grab the edges of the window frame. Broken shards of glass and twisted bits of metal dug into her palms, slicing through the skin right down to the bone. Blood geysered onto the frame and guardrail, onto her hands and arms and face, onto the floor around her feet. She couldn't see, couldn't hold on, couldn't find any footing. Everything was too slippery. She felt lightheaded from the sudden blood loss, and a sudden chill enveloped her as an icy breeze swept into the tilting car. It stroked her blood-spattered cheeks. Her lips cooled her forehead with its gentle caress. In the midst of her agony, she thought she heard a tiny voice telling her to let go, promising everything would turn out all right. But she knew that was crazy.
It was probably just the sound of her blood pounding in her ears. The wind tugged at her, pulled at her clothing, and an odd thought popped into Allie's mind. Now she knew what people meant when they said they'd felt the touch of death. And then the car moved forward again, and she lost her balance. Her feet slipped out from under her. Her hands were torn apart. The skin flayed from the bone by glass and metal as she slid along the edge of the window frame. Before she could even scream, she was falling. It was the mousy guy who saved her, snaring her right wrist with one hand as she began her dive toward the pavement. He braced his knees against the guardrail and grabbed her wrist with his other hand as well. Allie looked up with tear-filled eyes to thank him, then screamed as an elderly couple tumbled over his shoulders and out through the window frame. The old man bounced off of Allie, almost breaking her savior's grip, but the skinny guy seemed to have incredible strength, some kind of adrenaline rush that was powering his muscles. But he couldn't hold on to her for much longer. Her arms, her clothes were drenched in blood, and though the man did the best to maintain his grip, she was slipping from his hands. He knew it as well. His eyes were practically bugging out as he looked down at her, and he kept repeating, "No, no, 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 no," over and over, either because he was pleading for some sort of divine intervention to help him, or because he couldn't believe he was really going to drop her. More people were falling from the elevator, either dropping through the open window or crashing through the other glass panels. Some made desperate grabs for Allie's legs, and she found herself kicking at them before they could take hold of her. It was an instinctive action, that fight-or-flight state of mind scientists talk about, that takes hold when someone is struggling to survive. But she still hated herself for giving in to it. Tears filled her eyes, and she cried for the people she could not help. Most of all, though, she cried for herself. She was going to die, just when she thought her life was finally starting to turn around. Just when she'd come to realize there was someone with whom she could share that new life, with whom she wanted to share that new life. And now it was all being taken away from her because some fucking lazy repairman hadn't bothered to do his job and make sure the elevator was safe before people got onto it. It all seemed so stupid and so goddamn unfair. Allie looked past the man holding her to try and find Tom. She needed to know he was there, needed to know he was all right. She caught sight of the wedding band on his left hand, but she couldn't see the rest of him. Some kind of dark liquid had spilled on the window where he'd been standing, and it prevented her from seeing into the car. But then she realized the dark liquid was blood. Tom's blood. He was flattened against the glass, against the one window that hadn't shattered, his body crushed by the weight of the people who had fallen on top of him. Where his head should have been was a mass of broken bone and torn flesh and pulped brain matter that slid back and forth across the glass as the elevator shuddered and bucked on its broken tracks. What remained of his mouth was locked wide open in an eternal scream. His tongue bitten in half by the teeth that were now scattered across the growing stain. One eye rolled through the gore in a wide arc, still attached to the optic nerve that had unspoiled from the pulverized socket. The scream that had been building in Allie's throat became instead a torrent of bile that erupted from her open mouth. Beer and bits of chocolate mousse joined the clot-like hunks of partially digested catfish that roared up from her stomach to cover her blood-soaked clothes. She spasmed wildly as her stomach lurched again, and that was the moment when she finally slipped loose from the mousy man's grip. She saw him make a panicked grab for her, and then it looked as though the elevator was racing away from her. But it wasn't the elevator that was moving, the voice in the back of her head said. It was her. Allie tumbled backward, and now she was looking down at the lights of Las Vegas Boulevard. Lights that had seemed so very far away not that long ago, but which were getting closer with every passing moment. It felt like she was falling for hours, but a part of her knew it was all happening in a matter of seconds. Long, countless seconds during which she could see and feel everything with incredible clarity.
the horrified expressions of the Michael Madsen look-alike goon and his girlfriend as they dropped alongside her, the rush of wind drying the blood that coated her face and arms, the flapping of the broken bones and loose tatters of skin that used to be her hands, the sidewalk that seemed to be rushing up to meet her, long, countless seconds during which there were no last words to say, no flash memories of the special moments in her life playing across her mind's eye, no opportunities to express regret for all the poor choices she'd made in her 25 years, or to beg for forgiveness from the people she'd hurt by making them. Long, countless seconds during which she was able to turn her body so she wouldn't see the end coming, only to realize the elevator had finally torn loose from its tracks and was now bearing down on her, a glass-walled coffin that echoed with the shouts and curses and cries for mercy of its passengers as it hurtled earthward from a star-filled sky. Long, countless seconds, during which the only thing she could do was scream, a screeching, high-pitched cry of sheer terror that tore its way out of her throat and over her blood-stained lips. A scream that abruptly ended as her body exploded against the pavement. Chapter 11. The scream caught Warren completely by surprise and almost ruptured his eardrums with its intensity. Not to mention it scared the living shit out of him. It was difficult to locate its source even though he knew it originated from somewhere directly behind him, because the damn elevator was packed with too many riders for him to turn around. Couldn't two or three of these block-headed out-of-town fuckers have waited for the next car, he wondered? Hadn't they ever heard of weight restrictions on these things? He looked over his shoulder and his eyebrows shot up in surprise. Well, son of a bitch, butter my biscuits, he thought. It was the brunette who'd been watching him in the restaurant. What the hell was her problem now? What's going on? Shauna asked in a whisper. Beats me, he said, flashing what he hoped looked like a calming smile. This is all I need, he thought sarcastically. Bad enough, Shauna's still a little freaked out by that goddamn panther. Now we're stuck in here with some basket case.
Stop it! The woman cried. Stop the elevator! We have to get out!
Shauna glanced at Warren. Maybe she's claustrophobic, he explained. Yeah, or maybe she's just nuts, he added silently. It's not like the world doesn't have its share of crazy broads with big tits. Just look at that Anna Nicole what's-her-name. And they even gave her her own TV show.
Please, the woman insisted in a shrill tone. You have to stop it! You have to stop it now!
Oh, let her off for Christ's sake, said a man near Warren. The bitch is making me deaf with all that goddamn screaming. Shauna's eyes were as wide as saucers as she looked at Warren. It was starting to get to her. Easy, honey, he said gently. She's just nervous. He gave her hand a reassuring squeeze.
That makes two of us, she replied.
Over the rising objections of his fellow passengers, some of whom were pointedly telling the woman to shut the fuck up, Warren noticed the brunette had gone quiet for a couple of seconds. Probably her husband was telling her to calm down. They'd be getting off in a little bit. That wasn't good enough, apparently. Warren stumbled forward as the guy behind him slammed into his back. Warren turned to give the skinny, badly dressed creep a stern warning, only to realize it wasn't his fault. The woman was pushing against the guy, trying to force her way to the front of the car.
Stop it! Stop it! She kept saying. Please, you have to stop it or we're all gonna die!
That was it, Warren decided. Feeling closed in was understandable. Some people just couldn't handle tight spaces. But yelling about how everyone was about to die was akin to shouting, fire! In a crowded theater. It was dangerous and stupid, and it had to end right now. Hey! He roared. Knock it off! Everyone fell silent. The woman had made it past the other guy, and now she and Warren were standing face to face.
"What the hell do you think you're doing?" he growled.
"I'm trying to save our lives," she bellowed.
"Yeah?" Warren said. "Well, you can start by saving my hearing."
He reached into his jacket and came out with his badge.
"Detective Ackerman, Las Vegas Police. Now lower your voice and maybe I'll reconsider charging you with creating a public disturbance and inciting to riot."
"Charge me with anything you want to," she snapped. "But you gotta get everybody up this elevator."
Much to Warren's surprise, the girl grabbed the lapels of his jacket.
"Please," she said, a slight quiver in her voice. "You're a police officer. You can make them get off before it's too late."
"I can make you spend the night in a jail cell just as much," he answered, then glanced down at her hands. She was twisting his lapels in her fists. "Now let go."
"No," she yelled. "You've got to stop it."
"God almighty," said an elderly woman standing by the control panel.
"I'll stop the damn thing if it'll make you shut up."
She punched the button for the 115th floor, and the elevator slowed down. The other passengers groaned. Apparently, none of them were the kind of high rollers who could afford the suites on the upper 10 floors of the tower, so none of them were pleased by having to make an inconvenient stop.
"Looks like you got your wish," Warren said to the girl. His voice dripped with sarcasm. She didn't seem to notice.
"Thank God," she whispered.
When the car arrived at 115, the bell chimed lightly, and the doors opened. Now the woman began pushing in earnest, and Warren and Shauna were caught in the flow of humanity as it surged forward. Warren had a momentary impression that the brunette was trying to shove everyone out of the car, but that wasn't about to happen. If she were lucky, she'd be able to get out in one piece before someone got it into their head to knock her on her ass. Warren had to remind himself that as a representative of the Las Vegas PD, he couldn't be the one to do it. The chiefs at Metro wouldn't like it.
"Please, please, you have to get out," she begged.
She pulled at some of the passengers, pushed at others, but all they did was shove her toward the open doors, or look away and pretend to ignore her. And now Warren could see the tears running down her cheeks, the desperate pleading in her eyes. She really was convinced everybody was going to die if they remained on that elevator. But what could have put that idea in her head, he wondered. He hadn't heard the elevator making any weird mechanical noises, unless you counted the bastardized Muzak version of the animals, "We gotta get out of this place," that was coming out of the speaker in the ceiling. Maybe that had something to do with the brunette's panic. Songs about dying young weren't exactly what you'd call soothing. The ride seemed pretty smooth, no shuddering, no shaking, no vibrations. Nothing, not even in the glass panels or grinding of gears. And as a member of the Coaster Kings, he knew a thing or two about things that went up and down on tracks, even if elevators were a completely different kind of animal from roller coasters. With her husband in tow, awkwardly apologizing to everyone he bumped into along the way, the woman finally made it to the front of the elevator. It was clear that if the other passengers were unwilling to listen to her, she'd at least make sure her husband didn't take the plunge with them. Not that he seemed to believe her either. But her mind was made up, apparently, and the guy wasn't going to argue with her about the scene she was making. Warren shook his head. For a couple that looked as though they hadn't been married very long, the husband had certainly been pussy-whipped into a submissive role fast enough. Poor bastard. As she reached the front of the elevator, the woman turned around to address the crowd.
"Look, I know you all think I'm nuts, but I'm telling you the truth. You have to get off this elevator right now. It's..."
She spun her hands in small circles in front of her, apparently trying to find the right words to say that would convince the crowd of her sincerity.
"It's going to crash," she said quickly, like she didn't want to give anyone the chance to argue with her. "It's going to fall off the building and crash down on the street, and everybody's going to die."
Warren gnashed his teeth.
"Jesus Christ, that's it," he snapped.
He surged forward and grabbed the woman by the arm.
"You and I are going to have a little talk about what it means to be a public nuisance."
He pushed her into the gap between the open doors.
"You want out? Then get moving."
He turned to Shauna.
"Honey, would you mind waiting down in the..."
And that's when the doors slammed together right on the woman.
She screamed like she'd been cut in half. Ellie! Her husband cried. He grabbed at the doors, trying to force them apart, but they weren't budging. Luckily, if such a thing as luck could be considered in a terrifying situation like this, the man's wife had been in the process of exiting, so the doors missed closing on her head by inches. She still must have been in incredible pain, Warren figured, and the panic she was going through only made matters worse. But the doors couldn't have just closed on their own, could they? He let go of her arm and wheeled around to the old woman by the control panel. "What did you do?" he demanded. "Nothing," she said, hands held up like she was surrendering, or just to show she hadn't been playing with the buttons. "I didn't do anything." She was clearly upset, but whether it was from accusation or the sight of the girl caught in the doors, he could not tell. He stabbed at the open button with his thumb, pressed it in so hard the nail went white from the pressure, but the doors remained shut. "Tom, help me!" the woman, Allie, yelled. She moaned as though the air was being squeezed out of her lungs. "God, oh God, it's killing me!" Warren turned to the old woman and pointed the open button. "Keep pressing that," he ordered. Then he joined the husband, Tom, in his efforts to free his wife. "Get the other side," Warren told him, pointing to the left door panel. As Tom did as he was told, Warren took hold of the right side panel. The two men pulled at the doors, but no matter how much effort they put into it, the panels refused to slide back. It was almost as though the metal was putting up resistance, like the car was really out to do this woman harm. And no sooner had that thought occurred to him than he suddenly felt the car start to move downward.
"Tom!" Allie screamed. "Tom, it's moving! Somebody please stop it! Please!"
Warren looked back at the woman near the control panel. She was still pushing the button that should have opened the doors long before now.
"I didn't do anything!" she yelled. "I'm pressing the button! You told me to keep pressing the button!"
The elevator was dropping slowly, an inch at a time, as though it was savoring the hysteria its actions were creating. But that was nuts, Warren knew. Inanimate objects only tried to kill people in bad Stephen King movies, not in real life. There must have been something wrong with the whirring or the hydraulics. Well, whatever the cause, the damn thing was on the move and the doors still would not open, unless he and the husband found some way to pry apart the panels, or there was some kind of divine intervention. The girl was either going to be crushed to death or torn in half. Warren turned to the other passengers. They stood impassively, even Shauna, watching but offering no assistance. A bunch of doe-eyed spectators caught up in viewing a reality show that was being acted out right in front of them.
"Help us, for Christ's sake!" he barked at them.
But instead of stepping forward to join in on the rescue effort, they widened their eyes in surprise and moved back a step. All except for one who moved to the front of the car. He was the skinny, creepy-looking guy in a rumpled suit and scuffed shoes who'd bumped into him when the girl started shoving toward the doors. The word loser seemed stamped across his forehead. But at this point, Warren wasn't about to reject any offers of aid, any port in a storm and all that. Without a mumbled, "Excuse me," the guy slipped between Warren and Tom and reached up to the top of the elevator between the door and the floor landing. There was a sharp clicking sound and the door suddenly sprang open. Tom immediately grabbed his wife and quickly pushed her out of the elevator. Warren and the little creep followed with Shauna right behind them. The door slammed shut, just missing her, and the elevator moved on. Allie and Tom stood off to one side of the bay. She was shaking with terror, and he'd wrapped his arms around her to offer comfort. He looked over to the creep.
"Thank you, Mr.
Plug," the loser said. "Arlen Plug." He shrugged. "I worked on an elevator, worked in elevator repairs once, for about 8 months. All you had to do was retrip the electric eye over the doors."
"Well, why the fuck didn't you do that sooner?" Warren demanded.
The guy smiled nervously and looked at his feet. "I thought you knew what you were doing," he said quietly. "I didn't want to get in the way." Warren turned to face Allie.
"Are you all right?"
"Of course she's not all right," Tom shouted. "She almost got killed just now."
Warren glared at the man and debated whether or not he should verbally tear him a new asshole. But then the little voice in the back of his mind muttered a warning. "Ease up there, Wren," it said. "The guy and his wife have just gone through a major trauma. You'd be even more worked up than him if it had been Shauna who got caught in the doors. So don't go biting his head off because he's a little hyper." Yeah, he thought, that does make a lot of sense. Besides, there are plenty of other ways to handle this. "You're Tom, right?" he asked. "Yeah," the man replied and pointed at the girl. "I'm her husband." Warren nodded. "Okay, Tom," he said. "Now I'm going to need you to calm down, all right? I know how you must be feeling. I know you're pissed off and upset, and you don't know where to direct all that anger. All that anger that's built up inside of you. But it's not going to do either you or your wife any good by yelling at me." He put on his best, "We're all friends here," smile. "I'm on your side, okay?" For a moment, Tom looked like he was about to launch another salvo. Then the fight slowly drained out of him. "Yeah," he said quietly. "Sorry, officer." "Detective," Warren corrected him. "Detective," Tom repeated. Confident that the fire had been put out, Warren directed the smile at the wife. "And you're Allie?" "Yes," she said. "Okay, Allie." He jerked his thumb over his shoulder in the direction of the elevator track. "You fill up to telling me what that was all up." The building shuddered. Not enough to throw everyone off their feet, but definitely enough to get their attention.
"Oh my God," Shauna cried. "Was that a bomb? I think that was a bomb."
"It wasn't a bomb," Warren said assertively. At least he hoped it wasn't a bomb, although that had been his first impression as well.
Detective, I think you better take a look at this."
Warren turned around. The nervous, bug-eyed guy who tripped the door safety, Plug, was standing at the floor-to-ceiling window on the left side of the elevator bay. His forehead and hands were pressed against the glass, and he was staring at something down below. Warren ran over. He could hear the others thundering up behind him, but even before he got there, he had a sickening feeling he already knew what he was going to see. And yet he still had to take a look for himself, just to be certain. As he arrived at the window, he looked down to where Plug was pointing. "Jesus Christ," he whispered. The elevator, the very car from which they'd stepped less than a minute ago, was hanging off the side of the tower at a 45-degree angle. Somehow, the tracks on which it ran had separated from their moorings, had snapped off from the building, and the car was now suspended above Las Vegas Boulevard.
"Oh my God!"
Shauna cried, but it wasn't the shrill tone of her voice that sent an unexpected chill up Warren's spine. It was the screams of the passengers trapped in the elevator. Even five stories above the scene, he could hear the terrified shrieks of the people down below. People who knew they were going to die. Far below, he could see the flashing lights of emergency vehicles racing to the scene. Someone must have put in a 911 call right away, because the assembly of patrol cars, ambulances, and fire trucks were making good time, even with traffic at a standstill along both sides of the strip. But there was nothing they could possibly do to prevent what was about to happen. At 100 stories, the elevator was too high up to reach with anything but a helicopter, and at its current angle, too far out from the building for rescue workers to extend a ladder. None of that really mattered, though. There would be no time for a rescue, no time to stop what was inevitable. The tower shook again as another section of the car's guide rails peeled away from the concrete shaft, changing the elevator's angle to a rough 90 degrees. And then the first of the passengers crashed through the car's windows and began the long, fatal plunge to the street. Shauna moaned and buried her face in Warren's chest.
"No, no, no,"
she sobbed, and he reached up to gently stroke her hair, like that was going to make everything all better. More people fell as the elevator quivered, as though it was deliberately trying to shake loose its passengers. A crazy notion, Warren knew, but nothing seemed to make sense anymore. So why not a killer elevator? The air was filled with screams loud enough to cause small vibrations, even in the windows through which the small group of survivors watched the horror unfold. So many screams, Warren thought. So many bodies. that he knew the worst was yet to come.
Yeah, I thought it was funny how, like, the angry cop is like, "You're scaring everyone. Well, I'm going to drag you into the lobby. You can scare everyone out there. Like, get out of this elevator." And he's just so angry. Like, that's not how you handle that situation. Like, yelling at this woman who's clearly not attempting to scare everyone, who's clearly upset about something. Like, yeah, just yell at her. I'm sure that'll help.
Like, I just have a long line of people like an airplane just slapping her.
Well, you notice that in most of these Final Destination books, the cops are aggressive. Death of the Senses had it where the guy was paranoid about our main characters. Then in Dead Reckoning, you have a cop that she's aggressive and she doesn't follow the rules. Like, I felt like there was a requirement in these Final Destination books to have somebody that is a cop be a negative aspect throughout all of it.
Kind of like on Sons of Anarchy, every cop is crooked. Like, every FBI agent, every ATF agent, every person they ever get investigating them are worse bad guys than the biker guys are. But yeah, it seems like it does seem that way. Every book that has a cop, they're assholes. But it makes their deaths enjoyable, I guess. Except Death of the Senses, because we didn't get to see him die. If anybody bereaved, should have got a horrible death.
Yeah.
He should have ran into that room, pulled the trigger, and, like, it backfired and, like, shot him through the eyeball or something, you know?
Yeah. Maybe I'll write a sequel to that, like, I did that Halloween one. Where that one Josh guy in the Halloween book didn't get a death, but he was one of the nastiest characters. I need to write a bereaved ending for that one.
Ooh. Bereaved sees it happen, and he can't live with himself because he was only calling the guy a bum because he really, like, was in love with the guy. So he falls down crying for his death and has to kill himself because he lost Jack.
I was thinking more of, like, he loses his life savings and has to become a bum. No!
Drag it out.
Like, he's a bum now.
I want 400 pages with nothing happening for the first 200.
420 pages.
Yes.
He has to become the bum that has a premonition this time. Or it goes full circle. It was him the whole time. This is some mindfuck right now.
Okay, so we've got the premonition. We've got
the casino
happening. Now let's talk about death, tracking these people down. I can't wait to get to the part where, you know, the cop, where they're driving down the strip in Las Vegas and they have a wreck and the AIDS blood, it's just such a weird, it's so weird that the author went with this. Go ahead.
They had that throughout the book. I mean, Aldous alone, every other word was about genitalia or getting kicked there or how it aches or whatever. And then you have Arlen's entire storyline revolving around sex and genitals, and even his death directly correlated to that.
So after the whole thing goes down, let's talk about the dick cop. Go ahead, Sean.
Well, this cop is so obsessed with the child killer that he's like, "I'm going to kill that bastard on sight." And they end up in an alley chasing each other down. There's ricocheting bullets and people getting electrocuted and piss puddles and stuff. And it was kind of nasty a little bit.
There is a scene where the cops have these people in the car and they're just flying down the strip. And they have a wreck, and they end up at the hospital, and, you know, they all have to get a blood test or whatever, which is going to come back later. Just for one, there was a couple cool deaths in that wreck scene. I mean, that was pretty cool. In fact, that might be our third clip of the night if you guys want it to be.
Yeah, might as well.
Yeah, well, let's play
what specifically?
The high-speed like chase through Las Vegas into the wreck.
Okay. Yeah, I can do that.
Oh yeah, let's play that.
Roll it.
There was no warning of impending danger, no hint that anything might be out of the ordinary. One moment, the van and its police escort were motoring along Las Vegas Boulevard, past Bridger Avenue, heading south. The next, a set of traffic lights that hung over the intersection broke loose and slammed into the left side of the vehicle. The driver, a young cop named Sean Murphy, who'd introduced himself to the group back at the police station, died on impact, right before Allie's eyes, in a shower of blood and broken metal and shattered glass. The edge of the foremost metal signal cut right through his door and windshield, and right through him. He didn't even have time to scream, but Allie did, as his torso bounced off the ceiling of the van, then onto Detective Montoya's lap. Blood sprayed everywhere, and Allie let go an unholy screech as it splashed hotly across her face. She wasn't the only one screaming, of course. It was just that hers were the loudest, at least to her own ears. The van careened out of control, swerving to the right, then to the left, where a cry of surprise was cut short by a horrible thump, followed by an awful-sounding crash. Allie remembered the motorcycle cop who'd been riding alongside as part of the procession. It sounded like he'd been sideswiped by the van. God, I hope he's okay, she thought. The vehicle continued across the boulevard to bounce off three or four other vehicles. Allie couldn't tell how many, not being able to see before roaring back into the southbound lanes. Allie felt every collision as she frantically wiped at her face with her bare hands. Part of her grateful that Murphy had insisted she wear her seatbelt. Part of her wondering what had possessed her to wear a sleeveless dress to dinner last night. Clearing the blood that covered her eyelids, Allie was able to see Montoya slumped in her seat, either unconscious or dead. Murphy, whose arms had wrapped around her neck in a macabre embrace, looked about as shocked as Allie felt, his eyes wide with apparent disbelief that he could have died in such a bizarre manner. As the van swerved again, Allie looked to the steering wheel. Jesus Christ, she thought, there's nobody driving this thing. Instinctively, she looked to Tom, who was sitting directly behind the driver's seat, to see if he could help. But her husband was sitting motionless and blood was seeping down along the left side of his face from a nasty gash across the temple. He'd been struck by something when the traffic lights hit that side of the van, and for a second she thought he was dead. Tom, she said. Tom! She shook him, and he moaned. Allie breathed a sigh of relief. Oh, thank God, she whispered. He'd be all right, she was certain. The van lurched again. With no other options available, Allie scrambled to unbuckle her seatbelt, but the damn thing wouldn't come loose. Like it was stuck all of a sudden. She yanked at the restraining strap, clawed at the release mechanism, but nothing worked. It was as though the belt was fighting her efforts to stop the van from crashing. She glanced up to see where the vehicle was heading, and then her gaze fell on something that her panicked mind found hard to register. The bottom half of Murphy's body, the legs and buttocks, was still in the driver's seat, and as she watched, the right foot pressed down on the gas pedal. Oh my God! She screamed as the van picked up speed. It rammed into the rear of the police car that was leading the motorcade, the impact sending Allie and the other survivors jolting forward. Allie held her breath as the seatbelt tightened across her chest, forcing the air from her lungs finally. Then she was slapped back against the seat as the van swerved around the police cruiser and accelerated. It tore down Las Vegas Boulevard, weaving in and out of traffic, like it knew where it wanted to go. Allie frantically tore at the seatbelt, pulling it, stretching it, even trying at one point to slide out from under it. Oh God, we're going to die! Shauna cried from behind her. Allie turned around. The girl's face was covered with blood,
although it was impossible to tell if it was her own or just more of Murphy's arterial spray. She looked a little dazed, but not enough that she couldn't recognize the danger they were all in. Beside her, Ackerman was just starting to come around from whatever knock to the head he'd taken. Allie reached over the seat to shake him.
Detective Ackerman, wake up!
A siren blared outside her window. Allie turned to see the remaining motorcycle cop trying to keep pace with the speeding van. She was suddenly struck with the notion that he probably thought they'd commandeered the vehicle and were trying to make some sort of getaway. She pounded on the window.
Help us!
She yelled. Before the state trooper could respond, the van jerked to the right and clipped the front tire of his motorcycle. The bike went spinning out of control and slammed into a parked car. Allie had just enough time to see the cop go flying over the roof of the car before the van crossed the next intersection. Drivers and other vehicles stomped on their brakes and swerved out of the way as the van cut across the lanes of traffic. The siren stopped.
Where the hell is it taking us? Allie wondered. Back to the hotel to finish the job?
Ackerman groaned and Allie shifted around to face him.
Detective Ackerman!
Shauna reached across the seat to shake him.
Warren! Warren!
His eyes opened.
Jesus, honey, I'm not deaf.
Then he sat bolt upright as the van lurched.
Hey, what's the goddamn rush?
There's nobody driving the van!
Allie screamed. That took a precious second or two to get through his muddled brain. But then he fully came around. He looked at the driver's seat at what remained of the driver, muttered a terse, "Holy shit!" then looked to Detective Montoya.
"Izzy!"
he yelled.
"I think she's unconscious," Allie explained. "Or she's..."
"Then why aren't you stopping this fucking thing?"
he demanded. She pointed toward her lap.
"Because I can't get the goddamn buckle to open!"
You might want to try a little harder," Plug said and pointed toward the front of the van. Allie turned around to look at what had gotten his attention. A block ahead of them was the intersection where the Strip and Charleston Boulevard met, and stretched right across the middle of it, in the process of making a left-hand turn onto the boulevard's northbound lanes, was a 16-wheeled gas tanker, no doubt filled to the brim with gallon upon gallon of highly flammable fuel.
"Well, I didn't see that coming," Allie said.
She started pounding on the seatbelt release, like that would do anything to make it open. But then Ackerman grabbed her left shoulder and pushed her to the side toward Tom.
"Cover your ears," he ordered.
She turned in time to see him lean over her seat with a gun in his hand.
"Jesus Christ,"
she cried.
"What the hell are you doing?"
"Cutting you loose," he answered. "You think I carry a fucking Swiss Army knife? Now cover your goddamn ears!"
Allie did as she was told, but it didn't do her hearing much good. The gun roared once, momentarily deafening her, and her nostrils filled with acrid smoke. When she looked down, there was a gaping hole in the seatbelt strap and in the seat itself. Ackerman grabbed the material with both hands and started yanking hard on it, trying to tear apart the remaining section of the belt. Allie helped as best she could in her awkward sitting position, and they were rewarded with the sound of the strap beginning to break. The van suddenly accelerated as though whatever force was guiding it knew what they were up to, and now it was a race to see who was going to come out of it the winner. With the final tear of reinforced fabric, the seatbelt came loose, and Allie dived for the steering wheel. But no matter how hard she tried turning it, the wheel would not budge. The van was locked on its collision course. She gave up on trying to steer and scrambled to gain control of the brake pedal. She reached down with both hands and grabbed Murphy's right leg by the ankle, then tried yanking it off the accelerator. But the leg muscles were frozen like rigor mortis had set in, and the foot was still pressing down on the pedal.
"You know, if you're gonna do something," Plug commented in a surreally calm voice,
"this'd be a really good time for it."
"I'm trying, goddammit!"
Allie snapped. She looked up from her efforts to glance out through the shattered windshield. The side of the tanker filled her vision.
She looked away from the looming disaster and focused on the job at hand. Putting all her strength into it, she pulled back on the leg and succeeded in sliding it off the gas. Then, with a scream born of desperation and fear, she picked it up and slammed it down on the brake. The van rolled to a hard stop. Allie looked up as the hood of the vehicle lightly bumped against the wall of the tanker. Then she grabbed the keys on the steering column, switched off the ignition, and killed the van's engine.
"Thank you, God,"
Shauna whispered from the back. Allie released her grip on Murphy's leg, not wanting to touch parts of a dead guy anymore. But then a loud sloshing sound beneath and around her caught her attention, and she looked down. The top half of Murphy's severed torso, the part that had Detective Montoya locked in a death embrace, had spilled his guts onto the floor. And now, Allie found herself crouching in a pile of colons and liver and pancreas and stomach. She was in the process of shrieking when last night's dinner decided to take advantage of her wide-open mouth and evacuate her stomach, spewing what seemed like a never-ending, acidic-tasting torrent of catfish and chocolate and imported beer across the driver's seat, the steering wheel, and the dashboard. The noxious mixture slid down the black-colored upholstery to the floor, where it mixed with the intestinal juices congealing around her hands and knees in a ghastly stew. The strength drained out of her right then and there, and Allie numbly belched. A mucus bubble containing tiny bits of fish momentarily forming on her lips before silently popping.
"Oh, God," she muttered.
Beside her, she heard Tom groan. She looked up to find him touching the left side of his head, then gazing at the blood he found on his fingers, clearly at a loss to understand how it could have gotten there. He turned to stare at her with that sort of dumb, confused expression that comes over someone when they wake up and sense that they have just missed out on something. "Hey, honey," he said dully, "you look like shit." She would have laughed, but then some undigested part of yesterday's lunch unexpectedly forced its way up her gullet. Before she could turn her head, the projectile vomiting had recommenced, turning the crotch and right leg of Tom's dress slacks a grotesque shade of yellow-green.
"That makes two of us," Allie said with a weak grin, and belched again.
Okay, so now let's talk about the juicy deaths. Shauna's was a little interesting. Working with all the dangerous cats, she thought she was going to die at any performance, and then actually, didn't she get killed by a Jaguar car?
Yes.
I'm like, okay, it kind of reminds me of, was it Mrs. Doubtfire? "My husband was killed. Oh, it was the drink that killed him." "Oh, he was a drinker?" "No, he got hit by a Budweiser truck."
was she the one that the car rolled and hit her and then like the coins came out of her mouth or whatever? Yeah, I love that one. You had to bring that up right after a clip. At the end of this, I'm going to play that clip of her death. That'll be what ends the show. That'll be our final clip because that is my favorite. She becomes a human slot machine. That was the most creative thing in the book, I think. But DK.
I wanted to say, too, with that setup and her working with the big cats and everything, you're just kind of waiting for that to happen. And then the irony later of that coming to fruition where she gets hit by a car named after a cat, I thought that was one of the more interesting ideas and setups that the author had done. But my favorite death is Arlen's.
Tell us his death. Let's hear it.
So he gets to enjoy the company of his neighbor who's a voyeur and she keeps her blinds open. And they're going to town and everything goes to hell in a handbasket and he ends up getting his manhood circumcised beyond anything anyone should ever have.
It's bit off. It's completely bit off. Yeah.
Dies. I just thought that was so gruesome, and at the time of reading that, I was like, this is a really good way to keep anyone from having sex.
Right. At least right after an elevator accident, for sure.
Right.
Least favorite death, and not the second to least favorite death in the book, because we're saving that the big one for the end.
I didn't care for Tom. I thought Tom's death was very uninspired.
Go ahead and tell us about it.
He got hit by a truck. I'm like, we already had that. Dude at the beginning got hit by a truck. Like, was it at the end when it was like, we need a death? 5 seconds. Death. 5, 4, 3. Truck. You already have a truck. Another truck. There's a lot of truck deaths around this town. People getting hit by trucks all over the place.
It's the same driver. He's drunk. Don't worry about it. It's Vegas.
Is there some guy driving around in a truck just hitting people all day long? Is this Grand Theft Auto?
That's his job. He's got 3 stars up above his head right now.
Yeah. He gets out, just collects the money, and then cycles through the gun. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's got to be the worst death. Well, the one that isn't the end of the book death, yeah.
Yeah, any more unique ones that you liked besides the manhood getting bit off?
That one is the one that has always stuck with me. That one is the one that I remember so vividly, even having read it years ago, and even just before listening to your uploads, I could remember that vividly.
What about you guys' thoughts on how these characters figured out what was going on and their plan to, you know, avert death's plan? How do you think that was handled in this story?
I feel like it was done better in other books. This whole book to me was just uninspired.
Yeah, so? I agree. I just wasn't feeling like I think like looks. If looks could kill was one of my favorites because death actually was personified and was talking to the main character. That was interesting. Death of the Senses was a serial killer and premonitions. That was kind of interesting. This book just didn't really have that. I feel like at a certain point, it was just random deaths and
like
a lot of stuff that
Destination didn't... 12, you know?
We're
all out of ideas. Because a lot of the other books, when the characters start putting it together, what's going on, it's interesting and it pulls you in. And then when they try to come up with plans to fight it, to not let it happen, like, what if we do this? What if, you know, like Death of the Senses, how, you know, our two main characters are trying to convince the other people, you know, there's not a lot of that in this book. It's more just basic Final Destination, you know. It's like if someone took all the Final Destinations and just churned it into like a machine together, this is what would pop out.
Oh, no, I got it. I know what happened. Okay, so you remember in Scary Movie when the killer is smoking weed with all the guys on the couch?
Yes.
Okay, that's death. Yo, truck, another truck. Nah, dude, you already got hit by a truck. AIDS. Oh, no, everyone's like, oh, no, man, you're not doing that. What? What
yeah,
I say?
About to pass out.
I've only been around since the Dark Ages.
I'm about to pass out. It's AIDS.
Dude gets his dick bit off.
Let's talk about the AIDS in the room.
That was such a sour ending.
So the main character finds out in this wreck that we played earlier that she was infected with AIDS. Did they even say HIV, or do they just go straight to AIDS?
I think they called it AIDS, because I was... now, understand, at the time that this book came out, I
2005.
I had a couple friends that had just recently been diagnosed with HIV. So after reading this, I set it down, and I'm like, are they kidding? Because I'm pretty sure she gets the notice that she's diagnosed AIDS positive.
AIDS positive. I think that's correct. Oh my god. I'm like,
what are you even on?
It's like the guy thinks that's how it works, the author.
The author came off as very much a bro to me, just in how much he talked about male genitalia throughout this entire book. And then to throw something like that in the end, I'm like, did you really think about writing this book, or did you just throw it at the wall?
It's like if you ask the author, be like, wait, so she didn't get HIV, she just got AIDS. Yeah, it was death wanting to kill her, so he gave her the super AIDS. You know, it just bypasses all of it. It is so lazy, for one. It's so misinformed. It is anticlimactic, and it's insulting, really, you know.
In page 404, they do mention HIV.
Oh, okay.
And they tell her that she was positive. So, but it's still, like, it was like she was
getting...
They
tell her she's going to be dead. Like,
right.
There's no treatment, you know, no medicine that she can take to prolong anything, to live a normal life.
And people got surviving since the 80s. I mean, it's a death sentence for her, though. Like, what the hell?
Well, there's one part of your body, if you get the blood there, it's just, you're fucked, you know? Just... And it was that one, that's what happened.
Yeah.
It's like, really, death? Is death just...
Death's high.
Death is high, or just over it all, you know? I've never done that before. There you go. I get what the guy was, he was trying to be different, but if you're going to do it, at least, I don't feel like he researched anything or really thought it through. And this wasn't the first time AIDS and HIV was mentioned in the book. And it wasn't him trying to, you know, bring attention to it, to help any causes or anything like that. He was using this as Jason's machete. You know, this is, it's bad. That is what killed the book for me, slowly.
I will say that this book kind of reminded me of Friday the 13th, Part 8, Jason Goes to Manhattan, in the sense that they're in Vegas, the world of Vegas, all these cool places, ideas, games, and
we only get one human slot machine. What the fuck?
They're like, one kill happens in an alley, another guy gets hit by a car, another guy hooks up with a prostitute and dies, and then she gets HIV. It's just like, could there not have been any more Vegas-related deaths? It was like when Jason spends all that time on the cruise ship in the sewers of New York. Like, wouldn't it have been great to see Jason be in Times Square and go to the Empire State Building and, like, climb to the top and be hanging off the pole while all these, like, or just, like, just something New York-like or something Vegas-like.
Instead of Jason takes a boat to Vancouver and pops into Manhattan for a couple minutes.
I mean, I'm just thinking,
what about this book? What if somebody had went to a magician show and volunteered, you know, to get in a box and get sawed in half and something goes wrong? You know, something like that.
Yeah.
I was thinking about that, too, because in all of the deaths, they don't mention a specific casino by name. The only one that they ever brought up was the Imperial, which I thought was interesting because they said it's on East Fremont Street, when really the Imperial was on the Strip. It's where the Link is now.
Does this guy not research anything?
Well, I think that, and I was telling you about this before, I was listening to the audio again, and I'm like, what is his obsession with the Imperial? Like, I know I had a bad stay when I stayed at the Imperial in Las Vegas. But this guy must have had it so much worse, because he brings up the hotel, and when he talks about the hotel, I can imagine where he's at in the original. And I'm like, he intentionally brought this hotel's name into the book to tear it down.
That I can see that.
And the Imperial Hotel was still in Las Vegas until 2012.
Okay.
So to have that name and the details of the actual hotel in the book and just change location, I'm like, I know what you're doing. You're avoiding any lawsuits, but you really want to tear this hotel apart.
That's probably what went down. I would love to know. I tried reaching out to this author and I didn't get anything back. It would be cool to ask questions like that and find out for sure. Let's do our ratings, and we'll start with our guest. Out of 5 stars, what do you give the book?
2.
Yep. I couldn't give it a 1. Go ahead.
Because you're right, there was some cool stuff in it. I mean, I liked the Vegas thing. I thought Arlen was a cool down-to-earth character. I liked Shauna. One or two of the deaths were cool. But it's weighed down by all this stuff. I mean, you got to think, this isn't a movie where they're worried about running over budget. This is a book, an endless possibilities for 400 pages, and we're stuck in this hotel room, this back alley, a police cruiser. It's Vegas! I've never been there personally. It's on my list, but it must be more exciting than this.
And the hospital scene actually felt like sitting in an ER for 4 hours, you know, reading it. That's what it felt like. Like, I'm going to be here forever.
Well, the author could have done something interesting. Like at New York, you've got the roller coaster. He could have set it at a different hotel. Or the dolphin show at Mirage. Maybe someone ends up getting stuck in the dolphin tank.
Or the Vegas Statue of Liberty. I mean, something.
Yeah. Right. There's so many things. Or even having gone to, what's that hotel? It's the giant pyramid one. Luxor, I think. Having somebody fall off, because on the inside of the Luxor, it is all open airway where the hotel rooms are. So falling down, it's happened before at that hotel. People have jumped. So they could have done something more with just changing names, too. They
could have went a little way out of town to the dam, you know?
Right.
Had so much. I was thinking casting, the only person I could really picture was like, and it's funny you brought up Scary Movie. I was thinking Matthew Lillard would be Arlen, like a younger Matthew Lillard. I thought he would make a good Arlen. That's kind of who I pictured in the book. Any casting ideas that you would have for this one, Sean?
I don't know. It's kind of hard.
You know, this is a segment. You should be prepared.
Yeah, I know, but I'm not.
All right, DK, casting ideas?
If I were to cast Allie, I would do Jennifer Lawrence.
Annie, get it right.
It's Almarie Faith Goodwin Gaines.
But I would put Jennifer Lawrence in it. But honestly, I would never want to cast a movie based on this book just because I wouldn't want to end careers.
Yeah.
The detective, I pictured as someone, if not him, but someone like Jeffrey Dean Morganish.
Yeah, I could see that. He kind of has like the older kind of grizzle look.
Yeah, I could go for that.
Anything that, yeah, Jeffrey Dean Morgan, the guy that played Sam and Dean's dad on Supernatural in season one when he was only like 8 years older than they were. He's always looked older than he is, but not in a bad way.
For Shauna Ingalls, I had Shawnee Smith, who played Amanda in the Saw movies, for some reason in my head. She'd be good with it. She's really good with that.
Go ahead.
So Tom and Allie, I just picture some boring white couple, Dawson's Creek shit. That's just what I'm picturing, just very vanilla.
Yeah. Since DK Since DK wasn't here for Death of the Senses to talk about, which I'm almost tempted to redo that episode just so he can talk about it too, because we wouldn't have the book without him. Who would you cast in Death of the Senses as Bereave?
As Bereave? I can't think of his name, but he was on Law and Order Criminal Intent. He was the main guy when the series ended. I forget his name. He also does, he's in Jurassic World.
Yes, the guy that gets his hand bit off by the Velociraptor.
Yes, would have
Vincent,
him.
Vincent D'Onofrio?
Yes, yeah. I can see that, yeah.
Okay, I was thinking more of that old dude. He was the bad guy in Avatar. He went on to play the blind man in Don't Breathe.
Michael Ironside could do it.
Stephen Lang, I think.
Okay, Stephen Lang. I can see Michael Ironside playing Bereave. He's a little too old though, probably.
He was just in an episode of Tales of the Crypt I just watched.
Yeah, he was. He's on Smallville too as Lois's dad.
Well, that's interesting because he plays Darkseid in the cartoons.
Yeah.
Okay.
I
feel like we're so desperate not to talk about this book, we keep just getting sidetracked.
Right. Well, I mean, we've talked about it. We've got our casting out of the way. We rated the book. And, you know, this book, I can't even remember what I was going to say the last clip was going to be when we ended the episode.
Shauna.
The last
clip. Shauna's thing. But, yeah, this has been, what is this, episode 36? 37?
I got 35.
No, the last one was 35.
Oh, is that because we threw Voorhees into the mix?
Yeah.
Okay, I think that's 36 then.
Yeah, 36 episodes. We've caught up with my age. So this has been a discussion on Final Destination, Dead Man's Hand. Thank you so much for popping in, DK, and talking with us. We're going to be covering Final Destination 3 in the near future, the novelization. I'm about to start narrating the one I've really been looking forward to, which is Destination Zero. I'm curious about the Jack the Ripper of it all. That should start up late January, early February. I'll be on that one. And yeah, any closing remarks on this book, guys?
If you're going to read the Final Destination books, you have to read this one, and then you'll appreciate and enjoy even the second worst Final Destination book.
Yeah, listen to this one first, if you haven't listened to any yet. Just get it out of the way.
I think that's what gets me about this one, is that there was such potential. So this book was akin to the 1994 Bram Stoker's Dracula. It's got a stellar cast, but the movie completely flopped. So I like, it had such potential. So did this one. This book. I'm pointing at your screen that has the book.
Kind of like Cats versus Dogs Part 2. It had so much potential, but just it didn't have Jeff Goldblum. So, I mean, all right, yeah. So thank you all so much for listening. If you're on Patreon, we'll have After the Slash up pretty soon. We'll be back in our next episode with David Bergantino popping in with us. We're going to be talking about Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror, Twice Burned. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying thanks for listening, pleasant dreams, and be excellent to each other. See you next time.
This is Sean Campbell saying, if this one doesn't scare you, you're already dead.
DK?
This is DK. I hope you enjoy the books. We will be getting Final Destination 1 and 2 to the 80 Slasher Librarian soon.
Yep. Thank you for that. See you later, everybody. Happy New Year.
Watch out for that crazy truck driver.
Yeah, we survived 2020. The biggest asshole of all. We survived it. It's 2021. It's going to be great. I hope. Probably not.
The most disturbing thing about it was how eerily silent the place was, as quiet as a church or a graveyard. There were no bells ringing, no buzzers buzzing, no shouts of joy, no screams of agony. The lights on the slot machines had been turned off. The roulette wheels were stilled, the dice and cards put away. About the only thing still running was a display near the center of the casino. A giant turntable on which a brand new Jaguar limited edition was mounted on an angle so passerbyers could see right inside the convertible and marvel at all the extras. It was meant to be the grand prize for some big poker tournament or World Series or something that had been scheduled for next week, a tournament that would more than likely have to be played somewhere else on the Strip, if it was still going to be played at all, that is. Whether it was or was not didn't mean much to Shauna. She wasn't big on card games, and even if she were, the games would have been going on while she was working, so she wouldn't have seen anything happen anyway. But as she stood and watched the turntable slowly rotate the fully loaded automobile in front of her, she had to admit she sure wouldn't mind owning that Jaguar, even if she did have an aversion to big cats. She heaved a deep sigh in honor of all the expensive things she could never afford, like pricey automobiles, and hitched the strap of her Hello Kitty bag a little higher up on her shoulder. Time to head home, she told herself. The boys are probably driving Mrs. Barker crazy by now, and I sure do miss my babies. She turned to go, but then a gleam of the ceiling lights on a piece of metal near her feet caught her eye and she looked down. There was a large gold coin lying on the floor, one of the tower's special markers that poured out of the mega jackpot slot machines when there was a winning spin. This one was $1,000 coin. Shauna chewed on the nail of her right index finger for a couple of seconds, wondering what she should do, leave it or pick it up. Technically, as an employee of the show, she wasn't supposed to gamble where she worked, At least that was the policy set by Milos Houston. He thought the sight of his dancers and showgirls plunking quarter after quarter into the slots like a bunch of zombified senior citizens, or being cleaned out at the card tables, would cheapen the mystique of his performers. But the management of the tower had no such restrictions on the troupe. In fact, they encouraged it, thinking that it would help entice more people visiting from the other hotels to stay and spend their money after the performances. And if it was okay with the owners, she thought, why would anyone object if she tried cashing in the chip? Hell, if the show was going to be on hiatus for a number of weeks, she had to have money coming in somehow. And $1,000 would at least keep her in yogurt and cat food until the crisis passed. What the hell, she thought, and bent down to retrieve it. And that was when the Jaguar suddenly slipped free of its moorings, slid off the turntable, and began rolling right at her. Caught in mid-crouch, her fingers mere inches from the coin, Shauna had just enough time to hear it coming, to turn her head as the car lurched and realize what was about to happen. "Oh, crickets," she whispered, an instant before the bumper of the car slammed into her left side. She screamed as her ribs shattered from the impact, and then the car was pushing her down one of the slot-lined aisles, picking up speed as it went along. Desperately, Shauna clawed at the car, trying to pull herself onto the hood. The effort almost caused her to black out as her broken bones ground against one another, but she managed to get her hands to stop sliding on the smooth gray metal long enough to start her climb. And then the left front tire rolled over her right foot, and she shrieked as her ankle snapped. Her hands lost their grip and her body started slipping under the car, until her chin was level with the edge of the hood. The Jaguar continued rolling down the aisle, continued to accelerate, and in a red-tinted haze, Shauna could see people running after it. She was just about to start screaming for them to help her, when a sharp pain exploded across the back of her head. Her last thoughts were of Warren and her babies, and then everything went dark. Milos Houston heard the screaming from the casino and jumped up from behind his desk. "Stay here," he ordered the Mayo brothers, who were using his phone to make the arrangements for their transfer of their cats to a holding facility. Then he bolted from his office. Christ almighty, he thought. First the elevator, then the show closing, now what? When he got to the scene, he found a large crowd had gathered, clogging the aisles as they all tried to get a look at whatever had captured their attention. Some people looked sick. Some were crying. One old man in tan slacks and a short-sleeved shirt muttered, "That poor, poor girl," as he walked past Milos. Whenever he looked back at that day, Milos could never explain why he'd suddenly gotten it into his head that the old man must have been talking about Shauna Ingalls when he made that comment. But something, a feeling, maybe even intuition, if he believed in that female shit, told him that she would be the poor girl he'd find in the center of all of this. It caused him to panic, made him frantically shove his way through the crowd, knocking aside anyone who was too slow in getting out of his path. And when he at last reached the spot which everyone was standing, it was to discover that his worst fear had been confirmed. It was Shauna, and she was dead. A car had crushed her against one of the mammoth mega-jackpot slot machines, and her lifeless eyes were wide with disbelief. But it wasn't the shocked expression frozen on her once pretty face that would haunt Milos Houston for the rest of his days. It was that what was pouring out of her mouth. The car had smashed her skull into the payout tray, had opened up the back of her head in a Polack-like spatter of blood and brain tissue, and $1,000 gold markers were flowing over her tongue in a steady stream. They clinked dully against the Jaguar's grill before dropping to the floor. "Wow," said a shell-shocked college-age guy standing next to Milos. "Jackpot, huh?" Shauna Ingalls had hated cats. Not the house variety. After all, a tortoiseshell named Jolly and a stray black tom named A-Rod shared her apartment in Henderson, 8 miles outside Vegas. But the big cats, tigers, lions, panthers, jaguars, the massive sons of bitches you'd see on the Animal Planet channel, tearing into a caribou or a zebra or whatever the hell it was they ate on those nature shows. And in the end, just like she'd always feared, it was a big cat that took her life. Because a jaguar was a jaguar, even if it was a car. And in the right frame of mind, a 5'7", 120-pound brunette was just another potential mill on the hoof in its eyes, or its headlights.